My patient, 45-year gentleman, resident of Delhi, an engineer by occupation, presented to us with chief complaint of swelling in front and the right side of the neck for last 5 months, hoarseness of voice for last 15 days, and orthopnea for last 15 days.
The hoarseness spelling should have been correct, Junaid.
Patient was apparently asymptomatic 5 months back when he noticed a swelling in the right side of the neck, which was insidious in onset. Initially, it was around, to begin with, it was 2 by 2 centimeter in size, which has gradually increased and attained the current size of approximately 10 by 7 centimeter. The swelling was, it was not associated with pain initially, but patient was complaining of pain for last 5 days, which were, along with the rapid increase in the size of the swelling, the pain was dull aching, non-radiating, and associated with orthopnea also. There are no aggravating factors to the pain. The pain was relieved by medication. The hoarseness of voice is there for last 15 days since the onset of rapid progression. There is no history of dysphagia. There is no history suggestive of hypo or hyperthyroidism, and no history suggestive of distal metastasis like bony pain, jaundice, seizure, and hemoptysis cop. On past medical history, there is no history of any concurrent medical illnesses like diabetes mellitus, hypertension, and there is no history of head and neck irradiation in the past. Patient was married, he consumed mixed diet, there is no history of any substance abuse and normal bowel bladder habit. However, he had disturbed sleep because of orthopnea. There is no family history suggestive of thyroid, head and neck malignancy or colon malignancies and man-related disorder. To summarize my history, 45-year gentleman presented with swelling in the neck for last 4 months associated with pain and hoarseness of voice and orthopnea for last 15 days. Along with a rapid growth in the size for last 15 days, with no history suggestive of hypo or hyperthyroidism, with no significant family history and no radiation exposure.
Anything anyone would like to ask Dr. Suhani?
What is the significance of radiation? How did you take radiation exposure?
Ma'am, the low dose radiation, they are associated with the malignancy in thyroid.
So, how did you ask him?
Like, ma'am, like his occupation, whether some radiation exposure is there, occupational hazard, or in the residence?
What in the residence? She's asking.
How did you ask? Aapne patient se pucha hoga na?
Sir, kya sawal? Wo kaise batayega radiation?
Aapko radiation mila hai, isse to nahi pucha
hoga. Low dose will be where? It's not a therapy anywhere now. It used to be in the past. Adenoids and acne, that's not there now. What would be, where would the patient get an exposure which is low dose? You said occupation, which occupation?
So in a nuclear reactor, power plant.
Living close by.
Yes,
there.
Sir, close by.
So, we'll be in
so 40, ma'am, 45 years.
45 years. So what do you think is the latency period between exposure, continuous exposure and
development speed? Dr. Swani, kindly speak into the mic.
So he's 45. At what age?
At a young
like
age, ma'am. Less than 20.
Less than 20. So that time, what I mean to say, how did you elicit that history? I want to know that. But what was the point in your
You're
mind?
You're saying 20 centigrades below and 20 years and below. That's long time back. No? So why she's asking you is, although there is a division of thyroid cancers into those with the radiation in the past without radiation, now it's only relevant to those places like Chernobyl, people living close to nuclear reactors like Narora reactor, close by Delhi, Mathura and close by. So you should know why you're, I mean, you can't just write it. You read it in the theory book that low dose radiation increases the risk. In the head and neck cancer, we ask the same
but
question.
But they had written like the books, I think, lot of them have not been edited. So they were for mantle cell radiation and for...
That is gone now, no? Because there is no therapy given with low dose.
For a 45-year-old.
So we... prepared. You just don't ask
it
like.
Safe and simple rather than
but you will have to mention the history of radiation exposure in thyroid malignancies because I'll ask you because it's necessary. They are falling into a different risk group. Their management protocol is also changed. So you should know it. But you should be able to answer that. There's no. It's not that because you can't answer, you won't speak. You said no history of exposure to radiation. You should be classified. You should be clear to answer that. You can't just say, I don't know.
What significance do you attach to orthopnea in this case? You mentioned there is...
In orthopnea signifies retrosternal extension, ma'am. Because there is also history of rapid progression for past 15 days.
Examination.
So examination was done after informed consent and in the well-lit room. The patient was conscious, alert, cooperative, and well-oriented to time, place, and person. Performance status was 90 by Karnofsky scale. He was well-built on account of BMI that was 24, and hydration status was adequate. The vitals were stable, clinically was afebrile with pulse rate of 76 beats per minute in right radial artery. Blood pressure was 120 by 76 millimeter of mercury in right arm in supine position with respiratory rate of 14 breaths per minute in the sitting position. There was no pallor, icterus, clubbing, cyanosis, pedal edema, or generalized lymphadenopathy. However, there was palpable cervical lymphadenopathy, which I'll be discussing later on. All the systemic examination was within normal limit. Coming to head and neck examination, the inspection was done first from the distance, then from the near, sitting at the level of the eye of the patient. There was a visible swelling measuring 10 by 7 centimeter in front and the side of the both sides of the neck, extending laterally up to the sternocleidomastoid, superiorly up to the thyroid cartilage, and inferiorly going behind the sternum. The surface was nodular. There was slight mobility with the deglutition and no skin changes, scar or sinus. There were no engorged vein present and no pulsation seen. The palpation was done from the behind. The local temperature was not raised and it was non-tender. It was a multinodular swelling present in both front and the side of the neck. The right lobe measuring 7 by 5 cm, left lobe measuring 4 by 3 cm, and the isthmus measuring 3 by 2 cm. The thyroid was palpable. It moved slightly with the deglutition. The margins were ill-defined. The consistency was variegated. And it was extending into the rectosternal space. The lower limit was not palpable, low margin. The right side carotid was pushed slightly posteriorly, and the trachea, however, it was not entirely palpable, but in the upper side, it was appears to be shifted to the left. There was no palpable thrill. The Cocker's test was positive, and the Pembender test shows no facial congestion. And there was bilateral hard lymph node palpable in the level 3. On the right side, it was measuring 1 by 5 by 1 by 5 centimeter. On the left side, it was measuring 3 by 3 centimeter. The examination of cervical spine was within normal limit, and ENT and scalp examination was within normal limit. To summarize, 45-year gentleman presented with swelling in front and both sides of the neck for last 4 months, associated with pain and hoarseness of voice and orthopnea for last 15 days, along with rapid progression in size for last 15 days, with no history suggestive of hypo or hyperthyroidism, with no significant family history and no radiation exposure. On examination, 10 by 7 centimeter, multinodular swelling with variegated consistency, ill-defined margins, with trachea shifted to the left side with bilateral level 3 lymphadenopathy. Diagnosis is 45-year gentleman with multinodular thyroid swelling, clinically euthyroid, with a cervical lymphadenopathy, bilateral with pressure symptoms, probably a malignant.
Stage?
Sir, since the patient is less than 55 years, the stage will be 1 only, stage 1.
Sure. Well, one thing I always emphasize to all PGs, once you go for general physical examination, I would say majority of the patients, you have all the normal findings. So one thing that you should always speak of your own rather than written material, one. And number two, you can always mug it up. Mug it up in the sense that it's a matter of a minute or so. In a minute, you can just say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And if you have mugged it up, it'll be better presented without reading it. That's it.
Can you show us the description of this level 3 bilateral lymph node that you've said? Yeah, describe the level 3 lymph node that you've written.
Level 3.
You'll have to show it, no? Where it is.
Where it is. So just palpable will not suffice is what I wanted to say. You must individually talk about the mobility or fixity of these nodes also.
Anyway, so you have a thyroid swelling which is multinodular and you have nodes on both sides.
Yes, sir.
Level. Can you show us level 3 with your cursor? Take it there. Or with the... Mm-hmm.
Sir, here there was a node and also here. It was a different swelling, sir, here, this side.
Now, was that the only group that was palpable? Level 3 nodes? Or is it possible that you can't palpate properly?
Sir, yes, level 2 nodes we cannot palpate because it was the sir, the swelling it was enlarged, so it was not possible to palpate.
Level 2 can be palpated, 3 would be difficult. That's why they are asking you. And
4 and 5 would be more difficult.
Yes, so
level 5.
4 and 5 would be more difficult.
That's why they are asking you. Tell us the levels quickly.
Sir, the cervical lymph node, they are divided in the level 1A, 1B, level 2, 3, 4, and 5. Level 1A is submental, level 1B is submandibular, level 2, 3, 4, upper, middle, and lower jugular, and level 5 is the posterior triangle.
Lower deep jugular, okay.
The level 6 is the central group, and the level 7.
How are the 2, 3, 4 divided based on the reference points? Of the
sir, it is the cricoid cartilage. Above the cricoid cartilage, it is the level 1, and the, bit below the level 2, sorry. Cricoid cartilage and the
what happens to something which goes up yesterday? Watch it. Below that is level 4.
Level 4, yes, sir.
But roughly you can divide sternomastoid into three parts and you can get that also. That's a rough way to. In any case, the clinical examination would be rough. And it's not just confined to level 3. And it cannot be. So it's extending into, it's not just level 3, it's going down also. Are you clear on that?
Yes, sir.
Now, please describe the swelling once again. Is the consistency of the node same as that of the primary?
Sir, the thyroid swelling, which it was variegated consistency. However, the nodes were formed too hard and they were mobile. However, there was only slight mobility. It was not appreciated well because it was almost...
The other question that will be asked is, how do you say they are lymph nodes and they are not a part of the gland itself?
Sir, sir, there was slight mobility in the thyroid, which was, however, the nodes, they were not mobile on deglutition.
They didn't move with
deglutition. Yes, sir, they did not move.
So they are separate. Yes. Consistency-wise also, they were separate?
Yes, sir, it was formed only, sir, it was hard nearly, but the variegated consistency was there in the thyroid gland.
What else you missed out? Did you examine the cervical spine?
Yes, here? Sir, I mentioned. It was cervical spine, ENT, and the scalp.
And the role of thoracic, systemic examination could have been a shade better. As he said, for the general examination, you can be rapid about it. But what's your impression? Malignancy.
Sir, malignancy.
If you have to think of a malignancy, which type of malignancy this would be? What is the history like? How long is the history?
Sir, the history was only 5 months, with a 5 month swelling and the rapid progression for last 15 days.
So something is happening very quickly.
Sir, yes. Probably there was some anaplastic changes.
There was a goiter to begin with or it has appeared only 5 months back?
Sorry, sir.
Did it appear 5 months back for the first time?
Sir, it was, yes, a small swelling. It started from the right side first. Then
5 months back?
5 months back, yes. Sir.
Then it covered up the other side?
Other side. In the last 15 days, there is a rapid growth with hoarseness and the voice changes and the dyspnea.
What impression do you make? You said anaplastic change. That what do you mean by that?
Sir, in the differentiated thyroid cancer, so in the thyroid multinodular goiter, in the long-standing multinodular goiter, there might be some anaplastic.
It's not long-standing. It's just for 5 months.
So there is anaplastic change in the multinodular goiter.
No, but there was no goiter 5 months back. If I got it right.
Can it start de novo?
Can something start de novo?
Yes, sir, it can start DNO.
Or there are some cancers that go very rapidly.
Yes,
any
poorly differentiated.
And some varieties?
So tall cell variant of the papillary cancer.
Insular variety, tall cell variant. They are not anaplastic per se, but they behave that way. They have a behavior like squamous cell carcinoma, that's what they say. Any questions?
You said hoarseness of voice. Can you tell us the voice change that happens because of involvement of recurrent laryngeal and the voice change that happens because of involvement of external branch of superior laryngeal? Or will you classify both as hoarseness?
Actually, sometimes the question doesn't come the way you want it, like I said. She's asking you, what is the difference between the voice change that happens with external laryngeal nerve involvement versus recurrent laryngeal nerve involvement?
Sir, external laryngeal nerve associated with the pitch of the voice, sir. The pitch changes.
Pitch and?
Timber
of the voice. And especially affecting the
singers,
preachers, politicians.
Sir.
External laryngeal nerve should go. Right? And what about recurrent laryngeal nerve? There is a reason why it happens. If you're not going there, you can discuss it at the end. How do you proceed in this case?
Sir,
what does it do, recurrent laryngeal nerve? What kind of a function does it do? Now that the question has been asked, you can complete it.
Sir, it is the abduction of the vocal cords. So So if the recurrent laryngeal nerve involved, so there will be the vocal cord will be in the median or paramedian fixed position.
Will the patient be able to breathe or not?
So if the bilateral, if the in the adductive position, the, it will it won't be compatible with the life. So we'll have to make another airway. So
okay. Emergency so now airway. Bilateral complete or partial damage is more. Supposing it's surgical damage. Now that we are discussing vocal cord, bilateral complete or bilateral partial damage is more dangerous.
Ma'am, in partial, there will be, ma'am, complete may the...
Complete means she is asking again, I'll repeat the question. External and recurrent both, okay? Both. So, bilateral complete versus...
Right and left, both side nerves have gone. Complete in three, transected. What will be the position of the vocal cord?
Ma'am, in the mid position, ma'am. No.
What is cadaveric position? What is cadaveric position?
The cadaver, it doesn't go in the midline, no? There's some space.
Sir, slightly adducted, sir. Paramedium.
Okay, yes. So that is the most dangerous position. Why?
Okay. Why? Answer that.
Remember respiratory, inspiration, and collapse.
And aspiration.
Aspiration.
How do you proceed now?
To confirm, quadruple test will be needed. After history and examination with TSH, if the patient is clinically...
Okay, a couple of people have repeated and you should know very clearly that BRAF mutation is done very rarely in this country. So don't stick to it. Don't make it difficult for yourself. Triple test is correct. You can add the genetic test.
Genetic counseling, yes. Then only.
What is its relevance? We have already discussed that patients with that mutation will be radioactive iodine resistant. Which will make a special case because in adjuvant setting you may not be able to provide that treatment. So that's useful for planning the therapy and of course the prognosis. But it's not a routine. You mentioned quadruple but don't stick to it. Okay? So what will you do?
Sir,
high resolution ultrasound is what she mentioned, so we won't cover it. You've done it and it turns out to be what you're looking for. Say, let's give you a scenario, it's a medullary carcinoma.
If it is medullary, then we'll work up for the
men's syndrome. No, we've done an FNAC, it's a surprise, it's a medullary. Now what do you do
next? We'll work up for the men's syndrome.
Okay.
Then 24-hour urinary catecholamines and for serum calcium and vitamin D, if a men one. Sorry. Yes, sir, 24-hour urinary catecholamine. Then serum calcitonin
some imaging?
Sir, yes. For imaging, then CT or MRI will be needed.
No, imaging of what? Foot?
Sir, abdomen. For
so you complete your answer.
Yes, sir.
You're looking for MEN syndrome, then you look for both?
Pancreas, parathyroid, pancreas.
That is the first thing you look for, right? Yes, sir. Not adrenals?
Sir, adrenal, yes, sir. Sir, 24 urinary catecholamines.
That's one test, so imaging I was asking.
Imaging, yes, sir.
So you look for FIO.
FIO.
FNA is papillary. Answer is already got, we got. The patient has got an FNA. FNA cannot give you a diagnosis of, it cannot tell you about the grade, it cannot tell you about the variety that you're looking at. Now, how do you prepare managing this patient? How do you prepare yourself and counsel the patient for surgery?
Sir, already there is hoarseness, which is the indication of recurrent laryngeal nerve involvement.
So what will you do more?
Sir, first I will counsel the patient about, then we'll confirm later with the indirect laryngoscopy also. Sometimes there is some viral laryngitis also, which may present as a hoarseness of the voice, which can mimic as the recurrent laryngeal involvement. We can rule out, or we will counsel the patient if the recurrent laryngeal nerve is involved. We'll have to remove, and the postoperatively this hoarseness of voice won't change. So it
is that the only problem? The tumor which is infiltrated into the recurrent laryngeal nerve is good news or bad news?
So it's a bad news, sir.
So you'll need to explain the prognosis to the patient completely. What will you ask the patient? We are not going for thyroidectomy surgery related questions. We'll ask, how would you counsel this patient? What all may be needed?
Sir, another airway will be needed of a consent for
tracheostomy. What is another airway?
Sir, tracheostomy.
So consent for ventilation, tracheostomy, okay. What else? Is it possible, suppose this turns out to be anaplastic, to complete the job? To remove the whole gland?
No, sir. It won't be possible to remove.
Well, suppose you don't know. Maybe it depends. So
if the trachea is grossly infiltrated or so we can leave the tissue, some tissue behind, and we'll explain the patient. Patient would be needing external beam radiation for postoperatively.
And also there is a role of what are the various modalities available for anaplastic? Is tracheostomy a good option?
Sir, if it is anaplastic, tracheostomy would be the bad option because we have breached the trachea, then it will infiltrate and grow inside the bronchus.
Inside. So it's not preferred to do a tracheostomy up front. But you need to clear off the trachea.
Yes, sir. Only, yes, sir. To relieve the pressure symptom, we'll have to clear.
But suppose it is papillary and it is resectable. Now what do you do? I took that Dettol to cover up the anaplastic part.
Sir, if it is papillary, then total thyroidectomy with the central compartment lymphodissection with bilateral neck dissection from level 2 to level 5.
So you will, in this case, not have a doubt.
Yes, sir.
These are cases where there is no confusion. You will do a total thyroidectomy along with bilateral neck dissection, which is MRND type 3 in most cases, along with central neck dissection. What is central neck dissection? What are the boundaries?
Sir, the boundaries, horizontal, superiorly it is the hyoid bone, inferiorly the suprasternal notch or innominate vein, and laterally both the internal jugular veins.
It's not suprasternal notch or innominate vein, it's innominate vein only. Vein, yes. Okay, so you should be clear. The level 6 has to be cleared there. What is the probability if level central compartment is involved?
Sir, chances of recurrent laryngeal.
I didn't even ask you the question. See, same YouTube phenomenon. This was also put on the YouTube. The CME that happened at ESI, we had discovered central compartment involvement, then chances of lateral being involved are?
Sir.
Central compartment is positive. What are the chances of lateral compartment being positive? 80%. And vice versa also is true. If the lateral compartment is positive, the central compartment being positive are 80% chances. So you would do both neck dissections in this case. Okay,
yes,
suppose you are not able to operate on the table, you need to take care that you don't cause any morbidity by damaging the esophagus or trachea, and you can clear it off. Any questions, final questions?
So, why is it said that the incidence of hypocalcemia or parathyroid insufficiency is high after central lymph node dissection, complete central lymph node dissection? Is it or is it not? Is it correct? Yes. Why is it high?
Ma'am, chances of injury to the inferior thyroid artery, which is supplying the parathyroid gland.
It's
no. One thing.
Yes, ma'am.
Again, the question. Where are the parathyroids and these recurrent laryngeal nerve lying? In the central compartment. You are dissecting the central compartment.
Yes,
so you will cause ischemia to the glands.
Yes,
rather than saying damage to inferior thyroid artery.
Direct damage.
I stopped
direct
because of
removal
this
also, you know, yes, because sometimes you may find inferior parathyroids in the thymic tissue and all that gets removed here.
Yes,
you understood the question? And the answer is, I'm operating there only.
There.
So if you're operating there, you're likely to remove. How would you differentiate a parathyroid from a lymph node? I am now asking.
Sir, parathyroid first by its color, it's a golden yellow, and it is associated with the sentinel lymph node, sentinel pad of fat. And parathyroid changes its color when we approach it from the golden yellow to the like angry looking thyroid.
Yeah, you said it's anaplastic probably. So what is restive index? Do you have an idea what is restive index?
You tell him.
Okay, it's the blood flow into the thyroid, which is calculated to distinguish between malignancy and benign, or hyperthyroidism and malignancy.
Role of PET scan?
Hello. Sir, no, there is no role of PET scan. Sir, distant metastasis is not PET avid, sir. They are not PET avid, so there is no role.
Not
of
as
PET,
avid,
yes,
as they should,
yes,
be.
Sir.
Basically, the problem is if it is BRAF mutation positive, you know there is no scan you can do. There is no radioactive iodine you can do. Therefore, in such a case, it will be useful. They will get external beam radiation as anaplastic cancers, as you mentioned, and some chemotherapy also, doxorubicin-based chemotherapy. But by and large, anaplastic will have a history plus examination findings together. It's not just history or not just examination. And then, of course, the histology. And all anaplastic are not completely anaplastic. There can be poorly differentiated ones which can take a little bit of radioactive iodine. So therapy available is radiation in most of them. So you need to be clear on that and take a consent. That's why it's important. Anaplastic is a different set. But whenever possible, we should do total thyroidectomy and neck dissection to get rid of all the cancer that you have so that you can target with radioactive iodine the metastasis, follow it up with thyroglobulin. Any problem with thyroglobulin as a marker? One was that, as rightly mentioned, in low risk you don't need it. And there's also a group of patients where there are anti-thyroglobulin antibodies, especially those that come with a Hashimoto's and lymphocytes. So they may not have, they may have a low level, but that's a false low.
False negative.
So you should be careful about it. I think with that we conclude it. Thank you.
One very common question asked by anybody who gets a thyroid case, indications of a thyroid scan in a case of thyroid swelling.
So if it's a in case of hyperthyroidism, the only indication is this.
Thyroid scan
indications are very limited, although this should have been in the previous case.
Yeah.
A toxic gland, when the patient is thyrotoxic, ectopic thyroid, or also ectopic goiter, like tongue, wherever. And when you've done total thyroidectomy, to assess the adequacy of total thyroidectomy. How much is considered an R0 with a scan?
So when the uptake is less than 3%, post-op.
They say 1%. 1 to 3 is all right. So if it is, because you don't have a true capsule in thyroid, so you can't have a margin assessment like you talk about. Although you talk of extra capsular spread, but you can't. In such a case, you can't really. So, predictive iodine, you do, a scan is not a routine workup. Therefore, quadruple and triple test, unless the patient is ectopic gland, toxic patient. And that also has lost relevance because toxic, they were finding out which part of the gland is active so that they could remove it. Now, since a lot of most patients with bilateral disease get a total thyroidectomy, so there's usually no confusion. But definitely as a post-operative follow-up.
I think mainly with thyroid nodule, if it is a toxic, probably then you have to do it.
Thank you. Give a round of applause. With that, we conclude this session, I think.